Coco Couture presents The Man of Style. Starring Carmen Bucco.
I'm Carmen Bucco, your host of The Man of Style. We have a special co-host with us this evening.
Matt Joseph.
And we stuck Matt in the corner because we wanted Jocelyn to take up most of the show.
Hi, everybody.
So we're talking about Movember, right?
Yeah.
And I'm trying to get everybody's opinion. A lot of people like it, but they're saying I'm looking a little too white with it. I might have to dye that too.
Again, it's like I said last week. Gray, much better than bald.
Now I'm too distinguished. Before I was distinguished, now I'm too distinguished.
No,
I don't think so.
I think, no.
I like it. I think you have the salt and pepper, more pepper.
I feel a little salty.
Yeah. You got the salt going down, salt and pepper going down here. You know, the receding hairline and thinning hair and bald spot in the back.
Did you see that bald spot back there?
No, do you? I was just teasing
No,
you.
I cover it. Just for men.
Okay.
Big man fan.
Yeah.
I am. I do it myself, too. Sometimes I let my girl do it. But we are excited. Jocelyn came in. Jocelyn owns her own real estate company,
yes.
Right?
I work for Coldwell Banker, but I have my own team within Coldwell Banker that I do own, yes.
And what I love about Jocelyn is she's a real, you're like an entrepreneur of entrepreneurs.
That I am. Thank you.
I mean, she gets up at what? Like, just a quick routine of what you do during the day. Because I can't even do it.
I get up between 5 and 6. Which I'm trying to do 5, but it's not easy. But with the time change, it's been a little bit better. And, I do meditations. I work out. I write. I journal. I read every morning. So
you meditate?
I do, yes.
Anyway. And that's all before she goes into work, right? You do all that stuff.
That's correct.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
It's very good.
Yeah.
Meditation, right? So yes. Is it like yoga meditation?
No, I do yoga as well, but meditation is...
How do you find time to do all this stuff?
You have to have time for yourself.
I have time for myself.
How do you do that? Because I'm at this point right now where I'm spending too much time working, and I feel like I'm not getting anything done, and then I also am completely exhausted, like... last night, I just came to a point where I thought I was just going to pass out, and like I was getting confused. Pete was there. I was getting confused, and I was like looking for words, you know. And then I get a second wind or whatever. But like, how do you do that? How do you find the time to?
Well, you know what? We're going to get into that later because we actually have a really awesome guest.
Yeah, we do.
Just to give you a little few things about Kenny Anderson, Mr. Chibbs, I'm so delighted to have him. I got to thank Barry Greenstein, I'm sorry, for that as well. But Mr. Chibbs was born a year before me, 1970. At the age of 16, was considered one of the best basketball players in America. Was scouted by colleges in the sixth grade. First basketball player to be named All-City 4-time by the end of his high school career. I'm sorry, I don't have my glasses on.
Do you want me to do it?
Do you want me to read
and,
need help there?
And though? Named New York State Mr. Basketball and High School Basketball Player of the Year by Gatorade. I bet you he got a ton of Gatorade.
Mm.
I want some.
Like a lifetime supply?
But also, he's actually coming out with a documentary, which I'm very excited
to
hear about.
Yes.
So do we have Kenny with us?
Carmen, how y'all guys doing? How's everybody doing?
Hey, Kenny.
Beautiful, Kenny. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me on.
Hey, it's a blessing. Thank you for taking the time. I know it's a crazy night with election night going on and nobody's around, but we're excited to have you.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it, man. As you said, you know, my documentary is the premiere Saturday at the Doc NYC Festival. Down at Savoy Theater on West 23rd Street, so I'm excited. You know, we've been working on it for about 4 years.
Wow!
Got a great director, Jill Campbell, and Barry Greenstein, and BMG Vocals, who invested in my story, and they believed in me, and it's just about my life. So I think it's going to be inspirational, and it's not just basketball. resources. And the great thing about it is it's not over, you know what I mean? I'm still trying to figure this thing out and trying to, get it right.
Right. No, absolutely. So Ken, tell us a little bit about your life and you know, how it led up to all of this.
I mean, a little bit. I'm a child prodigy from New York, grew up in Queens, you know, started getting a lot of attention playing basketball, probably about eight years old. Went to Archbishop Malloy High School. My mentor, Vincent Smith, who's Kenny Smith's brother, who works for TNT, he also went to Malloy. So he was someone that was, I could touch, somebody that was there. So, I wanted to try to be like him and be better than him. So, he went from Malloy to UNC, and then he went on to the NBA. He won two championships with the Houston Rockets.
Wow.
And, but his brother was our mentor, Vincent Smith. So, went to Malloy for 4 years, prestigious Catholic school in Queens. And, from there I went to Georgia Tech. I got recruited, could have went to anywhere in the country. But on this day, which is interesting, it was always all over social media. On this day in 1988, I decided to go to Georgia Tech.
Really?
Huh. I decided to go to Georgia Tech in 1988, November 8th. So it was,
wow.
I decided to go to Georgia Tech
happy
in Atlanta.
Happy anniversary.
Yeah. So it's been interesting, and we went to the Final Four my freshman year. Georgia Tech lost to UNLV. Then I played 2 years there. I was blessed to be drafted 91. I did 2 years at Georgia Tech. I drafted 91. I was the number two pick to New Jersey Nets.
Nice.
I started my career out in Jersey, and it was great.
You miss us? You miss us here in Jersey?
Yeah, my first house was in Jersey. I used to live in Alpine. I lived all over in Jersey. Secaucus, Alpine, Fort Lee, Inglewood. My second daughter was born in Secaucus at the Meadowlands Hospital.
Oh, wow.
Nice.
She's 24 years old right now. So, it's been a great ride, man. But, it hasn't been peaches and cream. So, I've been able to,
That kind of led me to a question, because you had a quote, and the quote was, basketball is easy, life is hard.
Yeah.
And I kind of, I was trying to wrap my head around it. Is that what changed your life? Does that quote kind of get you inspired?
Yeah, it sums up everything. what I mean? After retiring from NBA in 2005, my mother passed away, and just everything was happening. It was so much negativity that was happening to me, back then. And this was like, I had to fend for myself. Sort of when you're in the NBA, it's a fairy tale, life, everything is given to you, VIP, everything is, But once that stops, if you didn't build relationships and build bridges, it's hard to sometime go back to those doors, they won't be easily open for you. So, it was something I had to get used to and work, and I had to figure out what I wanted to do. And I really just, paid it forward. I always wanted to just give back to the youth. So I started mentoring kids and working kids out, training them. I went back to school, got my bachelor's from St. Thomas University down in Miami. Got my bachelor's. They took my 50, I had 50 credits.
Right.
Well, excuse me, I had 40 credits from Georgia Tech. They took my credits, and then I went and graduated 2010 and got my bachelor's. So that was the biggest thing. I wish my mother was around to see me, go back to school and get my bachelor's. So I did that. I just wanted to just work on myself. We all have demons.
Absolutely.
But I think, in some cases, some of us want to work on ourselves, and some of us don't. Some of us just really don't care, want to keep going down the dark alleys and everything. And I just didn't want to do that. I'm just trying to, do something that I'm passionate about. And that's what I'm leaning towards, And, just giving it, paying it forward, just trying to help some of the youth, because I think they need more people to hear. Especially for me, the way my life was, it was I think I can go back and give some of these kids hope that they can make it.
Listen, and that's what a leader's about, you know? Like, who inspires you? And you guys got to forgive me. My dog knows that there's a ton of people here, and she wants to come in and join us for the interview. Who are some of the people that inspire you, Ken?
Nobody inspired. You know, it's interesting. I don't know. I've never really, you know, my mother passed away 2005. My mother was my motivation to work, you know, to get to the MBAs, because they had the infrastructure. They had the infrastructure where I could, you know, make money, take care of my family, take care of my mother. So, you know, I wanted my mother to stop struggling. So, and then after I got older and after I, you know, did these years, you know, in the MBA, 14 years, and being married, this is my third marriage, my first marriage, and just making mistakes, I think. You know what I'm saying? Helped me, inspired me to want to do better. You know, just making life lessons. You know what I'm saying? Just, you know, sometimes you just sit down and you say, "Shit, I don't want to feel like this." You know, over and over and over and over again. This shit is, you know, frustrating, depressing. I'm tired of feeling like this. I got to do something to get myself, in a better situation mentally. And that's all, you know. I think I inspired myself somewhat, just not, you know, being. I guess I go through slight depression. I deal with some other stuff, but I go to therapy, you know, once a week, and just to keep me sane and keep me balanced, and to where I could live a productive life.
Hey, listen, everybody needs it, dude. I mean, look, I love your inspiration. You know, I grew up in foster care, was out on my own at 16. And like you, man, you know, you work hard, you become something, you make yourself something, and the fact that you get to give back, that's huge, man. That's so basically, really, your biggest inspiration was you and your mom.
It was weird. It was weird. When I had everything, I wasn't really happy. I was just going through money and enjoying it. I wanted to make everybody else happy, and I really wasn't happy. So, I fought with the demons and things of that nature. So I really didn't, it's weird. Like, everybody say, "Oh, man, you're in the NBA, you making X amount of money, you're doing this, you're doing that, you should be on top of the world." But actually, that was pretty much the hardest time of my life, you know, somewhat. After 3 hours of going down
money becomes the root of all evil.
Yeah, it definitely is. the three hours, you know, after the games, I was going down, you know, certain a dark path. You know, some people handle it different, but I always say if you crazy before the money, when you get money, it's gonna make you more crazy. You know what I mean? It doesn't matter. You're a jerk before the money. It's gonna make you be a more jerk. You know. A worse jerk. So it doesn't matter. Money just, you know, hides all your demons, you just gotta, you know, check yourself. And that's what I've been doing, you know, with my kids and my family. Just check myself.
I got seven
biological kids. So I got eight kids. My stepdaughter makes eight. You know, I got five girls, three boys.
I'm not even one yet. You guys have any questions for me?
Yeah, I do. In the description of the movie that I read on the documentary's website, it says that in the film you go back and confront that you're haunted by some of the memories of the past, or haunting memories of the past. Can you give us an idea of one of those?
Well, you know, I came out about 3-4 years ago. I was molested, you know, when I was a child, like nine years old, and 11 twice. So I went into, you know, that a little bit. You know, first of all, when I was doing this documentary, it was very therapeutic.
Yeah.
But my wife was like, "Hey, if you gotta do it, you might as well be honest." You know, I was holding on to that for like 30-something years.
Wow.
So, you know, I didn't want no money from it. I want nothing. I just wanted to help some kids. Or men, adults, anybody, you know, that being molested and being abused, maybe go and get some help, because you know you act out,
right.
You live. I had basketball and fame, somewhat to hide it. But some kids don't have anything. You know, they go to drugs, they go to alcohol, they kill, they jump off bridges, kill themselves because they damaged. So, you know, I just wanted to be have that platform that I had being an NBA All-Star playing in the league for so many years. I think kids would, you know, want to, if I came out, they'd be like, wow, Kenny Anderson came out, maybe I better come out and get some help.
Yeah,
you know, that's
right,
how I saw it.
You get, and it's right, you give people hope, man. What do you think?
Yeah.
Kenny, what do you do on a daily basis to help your mind be, like, forward-thinking, inspiring yourself? What do you do daily?
Well, I do, I'm really, I got to start, got back. I like James Patterson novels. You know, I read a little bit. I get, and I've been trying to figure out, I have a program down in Tampa that I'm near 3-4 times a week with basketball, a breakfast club with Kenny Anderson.
Oh, nice.
So I try to, I do the workouts with the kids and everything, but I also try to mentor them, just give them, talk to them, life lessons, things that I've been through in my life. How could I help them, besides, on the court? Well, what else could I do to help you? So just kind of, I got to get better. I was a loner, and that's another thing. You hide when you're hurt. You hide, some of your demons. You're alone a lot. But I was a loner, Even when I was, somewhat in the league, didn't hang around a lot of people. But, now since I retired and everything, happens when you're in the league, you get burnt a little bit. People, start disappointing you, and you just get you're buried like, oh, man, I ain't messing with nobody. So you just go into your little shell. So you just, I got to get better with that. But I think I'm a slight loner. But I always try to think before I move. Think for certain actions and, what I need to do. I love cigars. Cigars relax me.
Very
I'm always
looking
for a cigar. I smoke Padrones.
Padrones,
1964 series. I just got a big one yesterday for my premiere. It's the 50th anniversary cigar by Padrone. It's like $100.
Jeez.
So I'm waiting. I'm saving it for Saturday.
Yeah. I'm excited. I'm looking forward to the premiere. I'll be out there.
Yeah, it's gonna be different. I think a lot of people, it's going to be basketball in it, but it's going to also, it's just my life. So a lot of people, I don't know, the sports, if you're a sports head, you're looking for just a basketball reel of highlights, you might not see that. You know what I mean?
Right.
It's going to be more of my life.
It's about you, the person,
about my life,
the player.
And you know what? When I watch movies, mm-hmm. I love movies about people.
You could watch all these
movies, but when you get into somebody's biography, and especially based on what you're telling me, Kenny, there's a lot of kids who were out there, and I'm a firm believer, coming from the background that I came from, and you came from somewhat of a similar background, single mother, so on and so forth, but these kids today need us because they're the future, right? We keep saying though it's election day, this vote matters because these kids are, they're the ones who are going to take care of us when we get older.
Right.
Yeah.
God forbid.
Yeah, definitely. You're absolutely right.
You got 8. I got 2 dogs. So
yeah,
you need people to take care of you. I got a whole dog can feed me when I get crippled.
Yeah.
Pizza. Can you tell? Pete, you got any questions over there in the booth? Just hanging out doing nothing?
I'm not doing nothing. I'm monitoring the show, making sure everything's going well. There are some comments coming in. We've got Mark, who says he's met you and hung out with you and said you're one of the most genuine, sincere, respectable players he's ever worked with.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, and that's just take time. I try to be genuine with people, and especially kids. And that's what, you can't lie to kids. You got to tell the truth. And some of us like to hide stuff, and it's a lot of politics involved when you're dealing with a lot of money and you're playing in the NBA. You don't want to mess up your brand,
right?
Stuff like that. But you can't lie to kids. gotta be truthful. You gotta tell them the truth. And I never run away from my mistakes. I try to face them up, face up to them, and learn from them. Listen, I did this. Okay, now what's the solution?
Right.
I can't cry over spilled my can. What's the solution? What I got to do to clean this up? You know what I mean? And I think I get some of my values from my mother. When I was growing up, she just told me, just be truthful.
That's it.
Just try to tell the truth.
And stay true to who you are.
And deal with it. Exactly. That's the number one. I won't change because I don't feel I'm doing anything wrong. I'm doing positive stuff. I try to tell people in general, just, before you judge somebody, get to really know them.
Yeah.
Get to really know them before you judge them. For yourself, don't let nobody else say, hey, you got people, it's funny, I got people I know, they be like, hey, man, I don't like so-and-so. And I'm like, why you don't like him? Well, my cousin don't like him. Well, my friend don't like him, so I don't like him. I'm like, hold up, but he never did anything to you, you don't even know this man.
Right.
Get to, he might treat, you don't know what happened with the other person. You know what I mean? They might have went through something, and both of them was wrong.
Yeah.
But, you run into a lot of that. And I try not to let people discourage me about other people. You know what I mean? I have to get to know them for myself.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I never listened to what people said. And I could imagine if everybody listened to what people thought about me. Yeah. Forget about it. Either you love me or you hate me. And I won't say the two words that people actually think. But do we have any more comments out there, Pete?
That was...
So,
no.
So
everyone wants to know why everyone looks so serious over there.
Well, it's if you were listening to somebody talk, I'm listening to an inspiration. Tell them they should be listening too.
What do you want us to do?
Kenny, so you told us a little bit about the documentary, and I agree. You're not focusing on the basketball. You're focusing on...
Yeah, it's basketball. Don't get me wrong. It's a lot of basketball in there.
But that's what led you to where you are today. So can you give us a quick glimpse into it? Like, give us a little teaser? Something that we should
Trailer. Go to my trailer on the website.
Mr. Chibbs.com.
Go to it. You see like a 3-minute trailer, and you'll see what I'm talking about. You really like it.
Good. I was watching it before. Yeah. It looks good. And
like I said, before you get into that, Jill Campbell, the director, Barry Greenstein, and BMG, man, they did a hell of a job. I got it, as far as putting money involved in it and getting all the footage and following me, shadowing me for 4 years. And
yeah, 4 years just,
we had the same vision. We all had the same vision on what the story was going to be about. So this was great.
Barry is a wonderful man. I've been dealing with Barry now for about 5 years. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you, that push that you guys had for that fundraiser, I mean, that was amazing.
We did a lot of it for the money somewhat, but also for the PR.
Yeah.
The PR, I had fun with the PR, man, It was great, I'm anxious because I seen it, the finishing product. You're just anxious to see what everybody else thinks about it, that's all.
Absolutely.
So it premieres on Saturday. Where are people going to be able to watch the whole thing after the premiere?
Oh, yeah, then we're gonna go to a couple more film fests, and you got distributors, and now you go to the business side of it.
Right.
Barry and Jill got to do all of that, and we got to sit down and discuss maybe Netflix, HBO, Showtime, whoever likes it, that's where it goes from here.
Now,
but
I think... Go ahead, finish what you're saying.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, where did you send our tickets for the premiere?
I send them to your address. They should be there.
Okay.
Friday. Serious, go to the website. I don't have no control over it. The festival handles all the tickets and everything. It's on my website.
Okay.
You can even the merchandise, T-shirts. We got water bottles. Just check, let everybody know to go to my website and Mr. Chibbs and
get
tickets and come.
Chibbs,
if you're in New York, I was big in New York, man, so I hope it's a sellout. You know what I mean?
So people can get... So the premiere's on Saturday, and it's not like a closed...
Saturday, 9:45. Yeah, you could go on the website and get tickets.
Anybody can go
and get
tickets.
It's actually a festival.
Okay.
Anybody can go. $18 tickets.
All right.
Yeah, and it's a nice night out in the city, yeah, man. So
yep,
definitely go to MrChibbs.com. But also, now that you mentioned the T-shirts, hey, Pete, how many views are we up to?
Six.
That's it? Where the hell is everybody?
It's election night.
We have like 6 or 7 shares right now. So
that's nice.
Everyone's sharing, and there's a lot of guys out there. They're loving Kenny.
Yeah.
Big Kenny fans.
Beautiful.
Okay. See, Ken, so we still love you up here in New York, even though you're enjoying
better,
the
New York
in
the sun. New Jersey, where I started and all that, baby. I love New Jersey, New York, metropolitan area. Yeah. I love
it. We love you, too.
It's a cool place up here.
Thank you.
So, I will see you Saturday night. I'm looking forward to it.
Okay.
And, you know what, Ken, let me ask you.
What? You get to go on Saturday?
Yeah, he's going by himself.
But why didn't you get us tickets?
I'll see. Maybe I'll get you tickets.
Forget it.
I'll see how much.
I have to ask for it. I don't want. I'll wait till it comes on Netflix.
I want tickets.
By the way, real quick, before we let you go, where are you going now? Now that the documentary's done, are you mainly focusing a lot of your time on helping kids and stuff like that?
Yeah, I do a lot. I do a program. I'm really looking forward. The name of the gym is the clinic, so I'm really the face of the gym. I'm trying to get to the point where I just work out, train, you know, high power elite athletes, guys that's trying to get Division I scholarships, guys that's trying to play overseas or even, you know, NBA draft combine, come down to Tampa, work out with Kenny Anderson before the combine, and get your game, you know, tight. So I'm trying to lean towards that. Love being in the gym, teaching the game.
Nice. So any of you're a basketball player and you're looking to go to a Division I team, definitely reach out. Right?
Go to the website, the clinic. That's another thing. Go to the website, and you can check out the whole, it's down in Tampa, the clinic.
The clinic. That's all they do, theclinic.com?
Yeah, the clinic. Yeah.
All right, yeah, so make sure you guys go to theclinic.com as well.
And get all my information, where I'm at down in Tampa, and try to build that program up. That's what I want to do. Try to build that program up.
No, absolutely. If I get down that way, because we're working our way down there, we're hoping to be down through Boca and all that with a couple salespeople.
Yeah,
if you know any good salespeople down there, let me know.
Yeah, definitely. I'm in Pembroke Pines, but I'm back and forth in Tampa a lot.
Beautiful. Kenny, stay in touch. Thank you so much for taking the time. We have to take a short
break. Thanks, Kenny. And good luck with the movie. Everybody go to MrChibbs.com.
Good luck, Kenny.
Check it out.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Thanks, Adam.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks, Kenny. So we'll be right back.
And we'll be right back.
Okay.
All
right.
AdmiralAirTech.com.
$15,000 sitting on my couch.
My husband and I won over $20,000 in 1 month.
With over $139 million paid out online, ResortsCasino.com has more players and more winners than ever before. Sign up now at ResortsCasino.com and we'll double your first deposit up to $1,000 free. And get a free chance of winning up to $2 million instantly. Be a winner. Go to ResortsCasino.com today.
Go to ResortsCasino.com. It's where the winners play.
Don't forget to enter Buco VIP and get 3 free spins for a chance to win $2 million.
Guy people wanted to meet? Do you have things in your closet you move around but never seem to wear? Or shouldn't? Go take a look and then give us a call. Let an experienced clothier help you build confidence, style, and presence. We guarantee that if you call, we can make you that guy. Go to www.buco.us or call for your personal appointment 855-53-BUCO. That's 855-53-BUCCO.
Thank you.
Are you an expert in your field?
Do you want your voice to be heard?
Maybe you have a great idea for a show but don't know how to do it.
Well, we can make it happen.
Email the New Jersey Podcast Guys at njpodcastguys@gmail.com.
We got rid of Love It and Lose It because we had Kenny on tonight.
Yes. This is 2 weeks in a row, but...
That's right.
I wanted to see that.
Oh, yeah? Oh, it's
Why are you looking at...
I'm making a joke because there's somebody between us I'm not used to. we're not doing Love It or Lose It this week. We didn't do it last week. But it's not because we fired danielM.
No.
Or it's not because he quit.
No.
It's just because we had... What was it last week?
You want me to remember that? I don't even remember what I ate 10 minutes
ago. But tonight, Daniel's got, election party?
A big party, yeah, an election party. I wish we could get some results.
I just can't imagine what that's like, going to an election. Do you all have to agree with each other?
That's going to be a tough one. One side of the room is going to be this way.
Yeah.
And then you start drinking
and start throwing your glasses at each other, and it turns into a little battle.
Well, I was trying to predict who was going to vote for who when I was going into the election booth. So I'm looking at everybody's facial expression. But how would you know?
Because you're not in there with them.
Well, I'm not going to divulge my secrets.
You do kind of have, I know, there's certain things that you can just, that are just indicators of how someone is going to vote.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Even the way they walk.
Oh, the way they walk.
Especially if they're rushing to get into the poll, you know they're trying to get to a certain point.
Right.
But I really wish we had some numbers.
There's the uniform. There's like certain people wear a uniform.
What's the uniform?
Well, it's like they all look like Janine Garofalo if they're women, right?
Okay.
That's the liberals. And then the conservatives.
Do they wear a red tie, the conservatives?
No, well, if they're wearing a suit, they'll wear a red tie, maybe.
So that's a good indicator.
No, I mean, just like the regular street clothes. No, it's not just wearing red. Like that mannequin over there, which the camera can't see, but it's like a sports jacket with like a polo shirt underneath, right? You know, it's a polo shirt. You know, the guy's probably going to be voting Republican. You know, you can just tell.
Right. So if you wear a polo, you're Republican.
Well, polos are very convenient and easy.
Yeah,
so I'm sure there's a lot of Democrats. What is that?
24, Trump 60.
And we got more polls closing soon. Nice.
Yeah, but a lot of these are,
BS.
Well, Kentucky.
Right. Oh, yeah. It's so early.
Alabama.
It's too early.
I'm telling you, they're saying this is going to be a crazy election to.
Gonna be.
That's gonna. Oh,
it's already been. It's been.
Oh, I mean, I went to my polling place, and now I've been in politics for 20 some odd years. I just live, eat, and breathe.
Yeah.
You know, but
I used to, but it was actually like affecting my health, so I had to like back off.
Oh.
It was.
What was happening to you?
Brain tumor. I swear I feel like I have one because of it. It fried my brain. It was worse than drugs. I should have gotten into drugs. Because the politics, I was so into politics, and it's like, I cared too much, and nobody else cared. And I was like, well, why am I getting so worked
up? But see, that's the problem. So, like a lot of people, and I don't really like to get into politics, you know, but I have to, because it's political day, right?
Right.
Election day, quote unquote. So a lot of people were saying that they're just going to vote for the one person, the Johnson guy, because they don't like the other guys.
That was me.
And I'm like, but you're throwing. Like, here's the thing. I come from a different point of view, right? Because I was in politics, and my ultimate goal was like I was telling Kenny, you know, stay true to myself, make a difference.
Right.
Here's the thing. Let's say I didn't throw away my vote and go with a Johnson type of guy. Okay. Then you say, no, you gotta pick the lesser of two evils, right? So then I go, okay, fine, I'm not voting. Wait, then I say, fine, I'm just not gonna vote. Well, you can't not vote because then you don't have the right to complain. So there's no way to win for somebody who actually stands on principles and ideals.
Fox 5 said it perfect.
What?
Vote on the Not on the two individuals, but on the policies, and if you agree with their policies.
Like Bernie was saying, like, vote with your heart, or vote with your conscience, like Ted Cruz or whatever. That's basically saying, between the two, vote your conscience, vote your heart, but pick one of us. But there's plenty more out there that are in line with the way people feel. And, I mean, look, there's never going to be... Gary Johnson or a Gary Johnson type is never going to win.
Rocky De La Fuente.
Rocky De La Fuente may win, but not Gary Johnson.
Somebody put down that they voted for Mickey Mouse. I mean, come on.
No, but that's the point.
I voted for Donald Duck.
I think it should have, because your vote, you're in New Jersey.
I don't know if I'd want Donald Duck's finger on the nuclear code.
My vote, when I punch that little button right there, that vote, whether my candidate won or not, my vote counted.
Okay. Do you think it's going to get your candidate to win in New Jersey?
It might.
No.
Let me tell you something. There's a lot of people.
No, Clinton won New Jersey already.
No.
She won it this morning before the polls opened.
She did. They called it.
They said, you know what? We're not even opening the polls. It's just for show.
I don't know about that. Anything can happen.
Well, look.
Right?
This is true.
New Jersey was the only state that voted against Lincoln in the 1864 election. So, just to put in perspective how intelligent New Jersey voters are.
That was way past
my only state in the Union during the Civil War to vote against Lincoln, who everybody now says is the greatest president in the world. So my point is, it's never going to happen in New Jersey.
We'll see.
But, what is more important than the election?
Yes. What's coming up, dude?
The Gentleman's Club.
Oh.
And the wheel.
And look, we got somebody we can torture tonight.
We have someone who we can really give a hard time
Can't
to.
Can't wait!
So you're here purposely for this. So what we need everybody to do, and we didn't say this at the top of the show, is make sure that you like and share this video.
Right.
Can we, go to the wheel, please?
Okay. For all of three of you that are watching, let's
go. This beard is, like, itching me. I think I'm going to shave it off tomorrow.
See, I'm liking mine. It's at least I have some hair on my head.
Oh, maybe I should put the wheel on. Hold on. There we go. We're going to spin it again.
When in A.
So, explain this now.
All right, so this is the wheel and we're going to talk about. Ready? Things to talk.
All right, this is things to talk. Where am I? Hold on a second.
God, leave it up to the booth.
We're going
to
spin that again.
Spinning.
Alright, places singles should go to meet other singles.
Didn't we talk about this last week?
Yeah, spin it again. We talked about that one. I thought we deleted that one.
Oh, you? Okay.
I didn't. That's my fault. I'll take the blame on that one.
Alright, are clubs and bars really good for meeting people?
Alright, so you're a millennial, right?
Yes.
You go to the clubs and bars?
Yes, sometimes.
And why do you say it with that kind of face?
Because I used it more. Now I'm business driven.
So where do you go as a young millennial?
No, I go to clubs and bars. Do I go there to meet people, like guys? Not so much.
So is it good to meet people at clubs and bars? Is that the question? Uh-oh. Somebody's battery died.
Oh. Is it good to meet people at clubs and bars? I would say it's a good start. You see where it goes from there.
That takes all the fun out of this whole conversation.
What do you think?
Honestly, it depends on the bar.
Okay.
Right? So I go to my brother's bar a lot because he has a restaurant there. It's more classier. Right? Clubs, I just can't get into. I am so bad when it comes to clubs. If there's more people there scrunching me, what the hell are you doing over there?
Just take out my eye.
No, I'm a deep man. Nice to meet you.
If
this is for the gentlemen's club, this one.
Oh.
That's the gentleman's club look.
Like, the first time somebody steps on my foot, I gotta get the hell out. I can't.
Well, I think you have to go...
At a crowded bar or club?
Yeah.
Oh, I can't stand that.
Well, here it is. You have to go
Sorry,
for a different
I'm just
reason.
Waiting
for the
camera.
If you want to go to a club to dance, then that's what you go for. You dance and you have drinks with
your friends. I'm a white Italian boy. How good can I freaking
Wait a minute.
Dance?
Do guys...
You're asking a girl to this question.
Do guys go to clubs with other guys to dance?
Yeah, pick up.
Like, hey, Matt, let's go out dancing tonight.
Yeah, if we were those douchebags, we would totally be
this doing. This is how I dance, by the way.
Put the booth camera on so we can see how you dance. Show us how you dance, Effie. Yeah.
He does, what is that, the pizza? Is that like the pizza twist?
Oh my god, that's hilarious. Well, girls are different. I mean, I like to go out with my sister. I have sisters.
Are you afraid, like, if you meet a guy when you're out dancing that he already has a boyfriend?
Well, my intention isn't to go out to meet a guy when I go dancing. It's to go dancing.
Oh, okay. All right.
So you just
blowed a guy off like he's
pretty much.
That's messed up. All
right.
And when he buys you a drink, you just blow him right off.
Sometimes.
See? This is why guys
how many
don't
drinks?
Go to bars and clubs.
No, exactly. But you know, sometimes guys are. I've met nice people, nice guys at bars and clubs, and sometimes it's a good thing. So it's a hit or miss, I would say.
Sure, it is.
I think it's very important the place that you go to.
So going to like a dive bar.
Yeah, you won't catch me at those places.
Oh, well,
so if I'm in New Jersey, where do I go?
In New Jersey, well...
To meet a nice girl.
North Jersey, South Jersey, around here.
North Jersey, South Jersey, I'm sure you get around.
New York right? City.
I go to New York City. A lot.
Really? See, I can't deal with those crowds. Especially, like, after, like, 2 weeks from now, I do not want to go into the city.
The crowds and just getting in there.
What's, like, a big club in the city? Like, Studio 54? Is that still around?
The Limelight? Did you go to the Limelight?
CBs?
Like I went CBGBs? To a rooftop place a couple of weekends ago.
Oh, those are
ago.
Big. Oh, the Grovestead? Grovestead or whatever that?
It was at the standard hotel.
Oh, at the Highline?
There's a couple nice...
I've been there.
There is a couple nice rooftop bars. I went to a couple networking events. That's
rooftop
not bad,
bars are
right?
pretty cool.
Yeah, networking I like event that bar.
I'd be afraid of falling.
Pizza
afraid
of
I'm
heights.
Afraid of heights. Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like my nuts are in my throat.
Yeah, do you?
When I'm up that high?
Uh-huh.
What? I'm afraid...
Is it the pressure? What's
all right, Carmen, when we go to the rooftop club, we'll dance together.
You need to
so we can protect each other. Yeah.
And just cool that.
What's up with this martini? Just give me a shot or a...
What is that? Is that your drink of choice?
I like Martini? 30 martinis.
Extra olives? Or extra dirty?
Both.
Yes.
Should we do another wheel spin?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it.
Before Matt gets carried away over here.
I'm going to go to jail for
it. I like dirty martinis.
No, it's like when you say dirty. All right, here we go. Moving right along to the next category is best ways to.
All right, this is the best ways to get someone else's attention. So you're at the bar, you're at the club. How do you get someone's attention?
All right, Bobby.
What draws your eye, Jocelyn?
I nudge him.
You nudge him?
Like, oops. Or I spill my drink.
Oh, you're a creeper.
What?
That's weird.
Spill your drink?
I'm sorry, it was an accident. Can I buy you a drink?
And then you pick up my drive.
That really works, though.
See, no, but see, you could be like, you know, I've got some clothes in my van.
You want to come see my closet?
You want to come see my van? I've got a mobile closet in my van. We could go change that shirt. Yeah. What are you, a size 4?
I usually smile.
So you ask the guy out on a date?
No, I've never done that.
Why not?
I don't know, I'm old-fashioned.
So you'll smile, but you won't ask him...
You should come up to me.
Would you prefer a guy come up to you? Like, would you rather him do the goofy, oh, sorry, I spilled my drink on your crotch? Or would you rather him do something more natural? Because you know that's where he's aiming, right? It's for the laugh. And he's like, oh, sorry. Or was something more organic or natural to the situation? Like, what... Because, I mean, that's... I don't have, like, a
standard... I don't do that all the time.
Do you actually think about that ahead of time? Like, do you have a...
Coming from guys, right?
Yeah.
We don't know what to do. We're like we stupefied.
Yeah, right. You guys are. I can
like, we
that.
Get, like, retarded. Like, we don't even know how to say hi. We're like...
Yeah. Hello.
So, Jocelyn, you're at a club. Do you get, like... Do you get guys coming up with the pickup lines? Like... The cheesy pickup lines. Do people still actually do that?
Like Kevin lost an angel or something like that.
Right.
I mean, I see myself in the back pocket. that doesn't really happen anymore because I don't really go out as much, but I got
but, okay, but I'm saying, like, when you did go out, like, and that's a common thing, like, where guys would just be like, hey, like, I don't even know. Hey, I don't even. Is it really? Like, I mean, tell me. Like, just hey, baby, and then they expect you to just be like, let's go get married.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Tom says this wheel sounds like you guys.
What does that mean?
The visual.
Oh, sorry. I got so engrossed in the conversation. Yeah.
I forgot to.
We're back. We got this. We got covered up by the wheel.
All right, so let's spin it again.
No, wait, we're not that. I want to. What about the pickup lines?
Gonna tell us some like corny ass pickup lines.
Like, what are some like really bad pickup lines? Like, come on, there's gotta, you know.
Let me think about this a second.
Like, I can imagine guys just being just blunt, crass, like just like idiots.
Well, first off, if anyone ever spilled a drink on me, I'd be pissed. And I wouldn't want to drink from them, and I wouldn't really want to talk to them. So I
that's not necessarily true.
Well, that's me.
Because it happened to me.
You've never had a drink spilled on you by Carmen, I guess, right? He does it with...
Nobody spills like Carmen.
So do you just, like, gently spill it? Or?
No, I'm, like, talking, and I'm like, damn it. Oh, I spilled my drink on you. I'm so sorry. Can I buy you a drink?
Okay. Alright, so it looks like, so it's not like...
And then what do you do, slip your feet? Oh.
He walks up and goes,
I can't get them anymore.
Oh my god.
Talk to Bill Cosby.
Jeez. Give me another crazy pickup line.
Alright, another crazy
pickup line. Because I need an education.
Well,
I tried looking on the internet, and there really isn't.
Somebody just can't be normal. Hi, how are you? You know,
that's
you're
what I'm saying.
A good-looking girl, right. You're pretty,
but do they have to do that? Can't they just talk
or
to
just
you?
Say, hey,
I'm going to call Hitch.
Call Hitch. It's a great idea.
Oh.
But just, we'll see. Hitch plans it out, if you really look at it. The guy with the pen and all that stuff. So maybe you do need to plan it out a little bit, but I think it does need to be a little bit more natural.
All right, let me ask you this. In your life, have you ever had a guy who came up to you with an obvious planned out pickup line that you've said, oh, I want to make this guy my long-term boyfriend? Or have you had a guy come up to you and just naturally start talking to you, and that's what turned into something?
But why is there going to be a long-term boyfriend? Like, right on the first date. Or not even on the first date.
That's what we're talking about, right?
No, we're talking about if you...
All right, fine.
If you meet
more than one date.
Well, how do you know it's going to be more than one date? Maybe she likes your pickup line, but she or you can't get past the first
date. You know that you're interested to go out on more than one date, right?
So we should go to a bar and try this. Like, have a conversation with somebody in the middle.
And we could argue about dating. And like, yeah, it's like, oh, hey, you don't mind. I don't know if you've been listening, but...
Right.
And then ask her...
It's like Night at the Roxbury.
Right. But, like, worse.
I've been referencing them a lot this evening.
Night at the Roxbury?
Well, because that's the...
Did you say before?
Yeah,
did you guys go dancing? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because that's the, like, epitome of...
single
douchebag guys that go to clubs.
Epitome.
Epitome, yes, excuse me.
You know? No, because I thought I learned a new word tonight.
So did I.
Well, you did.
Epitome.
Yeah. Epitome.
What did that mean?
Epitome.
Oh, okay. I like that word.
That's how you spell it. Just, never mind.
All right. Spelling lesson. All righty.
Here we go, Peter. Peter's spinning the wheel.
But it really come back to us.
And round and round she goes, which step nobody knows is going to step on when it
That's a good question.
When in a relationship.
Yes.
Hold on, this is number one.
Yeah, because I know like 100 of them.
I know, there's so many questions on the wheel now.
Questions.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Man, could you imagine? There's actually over 100 questions on there.
Wow.
Michelle Bell mentions meetup.com. Are you familiar with that
website?
Yeah,
meetup.com.
When in a relationship is a good time to give the other person space in your home?
Ooh.
So it's obviously...
Like, does that mean, like they have a toothbrush?
Yeah.
I guess. Maybe a space in the drawer.
I'm not giving up my drawer space.
I'd say, like, how often are they staying over your house?
That's because you could be with somebody for a while, and if they're not staying over, they don't need a toothbrush.
Right.
Exactly.
But would you buy him a toothbrush?
Maybe, yeah.
Aww. Just in case.
See, that would be like a nice, like, oh, I got this for you.
Yes.
And it's like, wow.
It's those little
things.
Yeah,
but that could scare the shit out of somebody, too, though.
It could.
You know what? This is way before I met my wife, but I dated a girl. And I thought it was...
And it, you know it's concurrent with your marriage.
No, shut up.
By the way, your anniversary just came up.
Yeah, it was this past Sunday, yeah. 7 years. Thank you. 7 years.
I was trying to read your comment, and it was actually kind of funny what you put.
Oh, about how I'm with her, and I put my wife's name.
Yeah.
You know, I am not a Hillary supporter, by the way. For me to type "I'm with her," yeah, like I cringed a little bit.
Did you come up with cold sweats?
A little bit. Well, besides the point. So anyway, so I dated a girl, and I thought it was very casual. And I was at her house. We were like, she had like people over her house, and I looked on her like TV stand, and there was a picture of us in a frame. On like the nightstand or on the like the TV stand.
Oh, that creeped you
did
out.
That
though,
freak you out?
Completely
did
creeped
have,
me out.
Did she have like? Did she have like chains?
I don't even know when the picture was taken. Like, like it was weird. Like I was like,
if
oh
you
my god.
Closer, maybe her head was like posted on her
it,
face.
It would have had to be because it was like before Photoshop and stuff like that. So.
Yeah.
But
oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Right? Like, that's a little weird.
Well, so okay, she went for the gusto. She said,
why did it creep you out? It creeped you out because you didn't really like her, or...
He met her the day before.
No, like, we had gone out, like, we knew each other, and, you know, like, we hung out a few times, like, but it wasn't anything, like, serious, or I didn't think it was going to be.
So after 3 dates, she was giving you a draw.
She was giving me a memory space in her house. She had a photo album that said "Our Journey." No, she didn't have that. But
now, I thought usually it would be the guy, right? So you go to the guy's house all the time, and he gets you a toothbrush. What would you do?
What do you mean? What would I do?
Oh no! Well, let's say, what if he gave it to you way too early?
Yeah. But what's early?
Yeah, like, what's early, what's late? Like, well, you know, second time, second date, he's like, he walks in, he's like, oh, I put your toothbrush that I bought you in the bathroom.
I feel like if it's the right person, it could be a couple of months, it could be a couple of years. I mean, it really depends on the situation.
It's about what you feel inside.
It is about what inside feels.
No, but I'm saying if a guy is very presumptuous and says, oh, I bought you a toothbrush, like, you're going out on a date, and he goes, oh, by the way, I bought you a toothbrush, I put it in my bathroom.
Yeah, that would be weird.
A little bit weird, right? See, there's all that timing.
But that could be a sign, right, that he wants her to hang out a little bit.
Yeah, but it's also like, hey, you're going to spend the night, too. Wink.
Yeah, like you're already planting the seed before we're even done.
Like, right, like we didn't even go to dinner yet.
Yeah, I think it needs to naturally happen. Like if you're there and you need your toothbrush and then they get it for you, and then it's a sign of, okay, he's getting the toothbrush, that's like a good step in the right direction.
So Matt and Carmen, this is what you do. You buy a toothbrush, you have it in storage. And you break it out at the opportune time. No, a new toothbrush. And you break it out at the opportune time. Like, you think, like, you don't want to wait. You know, like, oh, let me just run to the drugstore real quick. No, you have it ready to go.
Yeah. Yeah, you should.
Right.
Oh, so you just say, you need a toothbrush? Did you want to brush your teeth before dinner?
No, and then that way, if the girl does spend the night and she wakes up, she's like, oh, by the way, I was just hoping it would end up this way, so I bought you a toothbrush. Bam.
Oh, that
that's a fourth date right there.
Bam, that's a fourth date. That's crazy.
Yeah,
I got an extra toothbrush. Just go get it in the bathroom.
Right.
I agree with you.
I also really care about your dental hygiene.
There's no time. You know, it's all about... I mean, like, a relationship is, you know, at least in the beginning, is based on feelings, right? And attraction and all that crap. So, like, if... I mean, okay... If it's less than a month, and he's saying, by the way, if you ever stay over, I got a toothbrush waiting for you and all that stuff, that's a little weird. That's a little too soon,
yes.
Right? But if, let's say...
But why is that too soon?
Because you haven't even had sex yet.
Because you're planting the seed, and it's, like, way too far in advance.
Yeah,
so
but if she's coming over every night, what's the difference?
But let's say she's not. Let's say they've only gone out 3 times. It's less than a month. They've only gone out to a neutral public space.
Oh.
He's saying there's an afterthought at dinner. Oh, by the way, if you ever decide you're going to stay over...
That's creepy.
I have
say.
A...
That
exactly.
Sounds like a creep.
Right. So that's kind of weird at that time. But, like...
If it's a month and you're, like, you know, together all the time, you are sleeping over, stuff like that.
Well, right. I think it's more, it's not so much time as it is milestones, relationship milestones, like you've slept together.
That sounds like too much freaking work.
That's not work.
What's oh my god.
What do you mean?
You just gotta reach a milestone to get a damn toothbrush?
like Pete says, you always have
it's 99 cents.
Pickup lines are very lame. She loved the clothes in my van, you know, using that line.
Really? So you can use that line.
Yeah, you can meet, she also says you can meet people at the gym, you can meet people hiking, or a ski club.
Okay.
I didn't know there was those things.
Those clubs are since 1986.
Nobody's weighing in, huh?
We're changing the name of the gentleman's club to the Hung Jury.
Can we spin the wheel again? I like these questions. They're fun.
Oh, you want to do it again? All right, let's do it.
All right, one more wheel. Let's go. One more on the wheel. We got five more minutes.
Here we go.
100 questions of Carmen's amazing.
There's more. I had a lot of help. A couple of my friends.
All right. So it's
best ways to buy a toothbrush?
So this is a little bit deeper, all right? This is a little bit deeper. Being an independent person, how much does it affect a relationship?
Oh, big time. Mm.
Good question.
You're very independent, right?
Mm-hmm. I think this actually is not the question the wheel landed on, but I think this is a good question for three people that I know are very independent.
Well, I can tell
you. Well, I don't know about Jocelyn so much, but Carmen is like you guys are your entrepreneurs.
I'm an independent woman.
Okay, I didn't want to speak for you. You have your own real estate group.
You want to see the snap?
Oh.
Come on, Mario. You got to give him the snap. All right. And that's it. This is an Italian girl who drives a Cadillac. Jump
back. I'm Italian and Spanish. 50-50.
No shit, so am I.
Oh,
Italian.
Really?
Yeah.
Puerto Rican.
No, Spanish.
Cool.
So you don't have a dark complexion.
Latina.
I'm a Latina. Hispanic.
Not
Spanish.
Anyway. So here's an entrepreneur, a real estate group, a leader, and another entrepreneur. Does being an independent person affect a relationship?
Yes.
It does.
Negatively.
So, well,
talk. I have to disagree.
But depending on if both people are very independent, right? Because that's scary shit.
Well, then there's no real who's going to depend on each other.
Right.
And that's where things can turn dark.
See, I like
but are you saying independent more in the context of they work for themselves, they're not...
Well, it doesn't necessarily need to be that, but I know that people that are entrepreneurs... They don't work 9-to-5 jobs.
Right.
They don't work Monday through Friday.
Right.
They work when they need to.
Which is like all the time.
Which could be all the time. Yeah. And you need to have somebody that's understanding of that.
Exactly. And that's why I say they can't work.
But aside from that, it necessarily just has to do with the work. It has to do with the lifestyle, right? Like you're a very independent woman. You don't want a guy
Who go up in my shit?
Right.
Well, here's the difference. That I personally feel...
This is, you're going to get us in trouble with the sensors.
Oh, sorry.
What sensors? I don't think we have them.
Shit's not even a bad word anymore.
I know.
They say it on, like, FX.
That's true.
Anyway, I personally feel like if you are an entrepreneur or you're just independent, man or woman, you should be able to make time for whoever is the other person.
Absolutely, but they have to understand when you are doing your own, doing your thing.
Right, but it doesn't matter. Even though you're doing your own thing, you should still make time for who you really want to spend your time with.
Correct, but then, but they need to have flexibility when all of a sudden your own thing encroaches on that, and it's like, look, I own this business, and this emergency just happened, and I have to take care of it, and I know we have plans to go out tonight.
They have to be understanding.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
But yeah. I think most people are.
No.
In a relationship.
Well,
no.
No. I've never...
I think it depends on the person. Like, I look at my wife. My wife has got a lot of her own friends. She's very close to their mom. Like, she's very close to their family. She goes and... She's got that. I know people that are married, and their wives have nobody like that. So they rely on their husband to provide them with all of their entertainment and companionship all the time. So they never get any freedom.
That's sad.
Whereas, I know, like... I mean, my wife asked me, like, oh, are you off today? Because I want to go do something. You know, like, it's different. Like, she's, and that's why it works, you know?
Well, that's why it does work, and that's the balance that you and your wife have.
Right. And, but we would have never gotten this far without it.
You need a little bit of balance.
Yeah, that's all.
Right. But I also think, and I kind of agree with the fact of, and maybe it stems from my childhood, but, like, we're really, in this generation, or this world that we're in right now, you know, nobody has dinner the same time like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was with a client 2 weeks ago, and I was so impressed. Young man, economist, and he's married with 2 kids. He says, I get home at 6 o'clock, we have dinner with the kids. We put the kids to bed together. You don't find that anymore.
You know, I remember...
Because it's work.
Yeah, but you know
and
what?
You have
sometimes
to put time
yeah,
into
well,
it.
You know what? Then don't have the kids.
No, I'm saying about saying, you know, cutting your work day. And you know what? If you got to go back in at 8 o'clock at night, but spend time, like the family thing is so dated. It's gone.
Well, you know, I was
that. I remember hearing I was reading a biography about Dean Martin or something like that. And you know, he has that reputation of being like the drunk womanizer, and he had his women and all that stuff. But when he had his show on NBC, he had a very strict rule. His wife had a very strict rule: you're home for dinner.
Mm-hmm.
And he was. And even when they were like doing their shows at the Sands and everything, he was going to bed at like 11 o'clock as soon as they were done with the second show, while Frank and Sammy would stay up partying all night. And you know, he was able to do all the stuff that he did with his career by still having a domestic life that was normal for the sake of the children.
Because he made time for it.
Well, he had no choice. His wife had him by the cajones, you know? But still, but that's the point.
Wives are important.
Of course they are. Because without her, he wouldn't be able to have the family taken care of and all that while he's out making the money that she'll spend. So... So I think you have to have, if you're going to be a man or a woman who is trying to be independent and entrepreneurial, and you know you're making your own hours and you're doing all this stuff, the person you're with, whether they are in the same boat as you or not, doesn't matter. What matters is that they understand what you're doing is not what they're doing. What they're doing is working for somebody else to put in all that time.
So basically, I shouldn't look for a sugar mama.
No, you should always look for a sugar mama. This is 2016.
That's the exception, right?
I love independent women. They make a lot of money.
Yeah. No, but you want an independent, woman, not because she makes a lot of money, but because she doesn't need, like people say, she doesn't need you for just, you know, entertainment on a Wednesday night sitting around the house. Like, how sad is that? That people...
And also, independent women make a lot of money, don't want a piece of shit guy. They want their guy to make sure that they're making their money and doing their thing.
So I got to be on the same level?
Yes, or better.
Come on!
Or better. See, they're always looking for
their
goals.
Can I pretend to be on a better level?
You can
try. You can pretend, but sooner or later.
Sooner or later, it's going to come out.
Yeah.
The truth always comes out.
Hey, it's 10 o'clock.
Is it?
We've gone 2 hours tonight.
And that's because you didn't fix your
phone. Oh, I didn't set my... okay, now it's 9 o'clock. It's after.
So that's it. It's over.
It's over. I hate to ruin the fun,
anyway,
but it's over.
Thank you guys for joining us.
Date Matt is
I'm
going
Carmen
away.
Buco, remember,
back to Ugly Matt.
When you dress great, you feel great. I hope you get to join us again.
Yes, thank you for having me.
It was fun.
Yes,
we need you again.
You did a very good job,
and Matt,
as always.
Thank you.
Have a blessed evening, and good luck to the presidential race and everybody else who's running this evening.
Yes. Good night, everybody.
Good night. Thank you.
And nice knowing you, America.